Lately, there's been a lot of talk about digital learning. In the United States, we're spending $20 billion each year on technology in K-12 education. Is that a good investment? Well, we haven't seen a lot of change in student academic achievement. And more vexing, we haven't seen a narrowing of the gap between high-income and low-income students. So then, is it a false promise? Well, I don't think any of you in this auditorium think so, and I certainly don't think so. That's why I started Computers for Youth, also known as CFY, 12 years ago. So our mission is to help low-income children do better in school by extending classroom learning to the home. And let me share with you a story that has me a big believer in the promise of digital learning. Okay, so I'm in East Harlem. I'm in a school in East Harlem, and I'm in a room in the back of the auditorium, and I'm talking with five girls. And all five of them are sixth graders, and all of them went through the CFY program, just like all the other sixth graders in this school. And what that means is they all came with a parent or a guardian, and they got trained on the digital learning assets that we selected at CFY and provided to them on their home computer. So I'm looking at the girls, and I say, hey, so tell me, have any of you done anything on your computer around learning? And they all said, no. I said, whoa, wait, you haven't done anything? Like, not anything with your computers that relate to learning? They said, nope, not a thing. So I called on one of the girls. I said, LaTanya, tell me what you did on your computer yesterday. And she said, oh, yesterday? Yesterday I was in English class and I learned all about Maya Angelou. And she's a poet and I want to be a poet. So I went home that night and I got on my computer and did you know that you could read the first chapter of people's books online for free? So I went and I started reading her books, the first chapters, and then I thought, hey, I can write like her. So I opened up that program on the computer, you know, the one that lets you write things, and I started writing like her. I called my mom over. Ma, does that have, whoa, hold on. LaTanya, that's learning. And she said to me, no, it's not, that's fun. So what does that story tell us? That story tells us that digital learning does have a role to play, but it all depends on our perspective. So today, what I wanted to share with you is to delve into a few questions. The first one is, how do we rethink digital learning, given a student-centered lens on education? The second is, what are some surprising observations from the field? And the third is, what can all of us in this room do to move the needle on student achievement? So let's dive in with number one. What do I mean by a student-centered lens on education? Well, this is the traditional lens. In the traditional lens, the teacher is front and center. The child learns because the teacher teaches them. The parent's in the picture, but at a distance, because the parent doesn't have a very big role to play. And in this particular lens, what you see is if learning is happening between the teacher and the child, then it must be happening in the classroom, because that's where teachers and children are together. So now let's look at the other lens. So in a student-centered lens, the child is front and center, and the parent and the teacher are supporting the child's learning. In this case, the parent is playing a much bigger role in the learning process. And if it's all about the child learning, then that means the learning goes wherever the child goes. So it could be in the classroom, it could be at home. But why do I keep harping on this idea of parents and the home? Well, what does the research tell us? Well, here's a study that was trying to explain student achievement differences in state-to-state comparisons. And what they found was that only a third of those differences could be explained by school factors, and two-thirds, far majority, are explained by family and home factors. Well, that's not what we hear most of the time in the media. We think schools are everything, right? So let's dig a little deeper into this big piece of the pie. What does the research tell us about that piece? Well, what we've seen is that the factors are really comprised of things like parents' education level, it's the parent income level, it's learning activities done in the home. But what's most interesting about the research on this piece of the pie is that it's the learning activities done in the home that are most important. And that's a good thing, because that's something that we can change. And it's also something that lends itself to digital learning. So let's talk about the second question. What are some surprising observations from the field? Well, at CFY, for the last 12 years, what we've been doing is trying to identify the best digital learning assets and getting them into the hands of students, parents, and teachers. Just this past October, we relaunched a learning platform called myhomelearning.com. And what this platform does is it's basically a place where we've identified over 600 of the best digital learning assets that are free and online. And we've tagged them by subject, by grade band, and by student learning standard. And we've also field tested this. What we've done is we've shown it to over 13,000 students, plus their parents, plus their teachers, in 7 districts across the country, including here in Los Angeles. And while we thought this thing was, you know, kind of cool, we found out it was much cooler than we expected, because we are now clocking over 400,000 page views per month, and it's growing all the time. The other thing interesting about this site is it's not just that we're identifying the digital learning assets, but we're allowing teachers to put them together in playlists so that they can individualize the learning. So how do we make sure, if digital learning assets are really moving to the cloud, how do we make sure that low-income students don't get left behind? Well, what we do at CFY is we partner with public middle schools, then we offer our program to all the 6th graders in the school. For every 6th grader who chooses to participate, and almost all of them do, they have to come to their school building with a parent or a guardian on a Saturday. They get trained on the computer they take home. Now, that computer comes loaded with all sorts of great educational software and is also internet ready so that the family, when they go home, they can connect to a resource like myhomelearning.com. So let me tell you a little bit about Slinky Ball. This is a pretty interesting story, which is how do teachers incorporate it into their classroom? So Slinky Ball is a software product that was developed by a bunch of college students. You can kind of tell it's, you know, a little bit low budget. And what we found with Slinky Ball is that it was a killer app with our kids, even though that it was developed with not a lot of money. So the story is this, is there's a physics teacher. He's in Brooklyn, low-income community in Brooklyn. He's standing in front of his class, but the class hasn't started yet. And the kids have all gone through our program, and they went through our program that past Saturday. So they, what did they do when they went home with their computer? They played Slinky Ball, because it's so popular. So the kids, before the teacher starts, they're all talking to each other about Slinky Ball, and they're saying, hey man, did you try the basketball puzzle? That one was so hard. How long did that take you? Oh, that only took me 10 minutes. Oh, that took me 3. Well, I built my own puzzle. You should come over to my apartment. You should, oh man, I'm gonna whip your puzzle. And then the physics teacher says, hey, excuse me, it's time to start physics. Come on, this is physics class. Everyone be quiet. Hush, hush, it's physics class. And then a light bulb goes off in his head, and he thinks, well, wait a minute. They're all talking about physics. So I am trying to get them to stop talking about physics so that I can talk about physics? Does that make sense? So what does that teacher do? He built a whole unit around Slinky Ball, and he built that into his whole class instruction for the year. And why does this matter? Well, it matters because the students were then spending twice as much time doing physics during that unit, because they were doing it in class and at home. And it also matters because they were involving their parents. So let's move to the last question, which is, what can all of us do to move the needle on student achievement? Look, the key is you guys. If any of you in the room have an inclination to develop educational software, go forth. You don't need a huge budget. You don't need 3D graphics to make a killer app. I already showed you one. And if you are looking to find ways to test it in the field, you can work with us and just email us at tedtalk@cfy.org, and we'll help you get it into the field and get some testing. Now, for those of you who have really great ideas, share them. This is a new frontier in education. We need all the ideas we can get to make a better future. Thank you.